I would like to bring up the couple interesting demos from, since we are in Boston, I reached out to MIT Media Lab, and they have a bunch of companies that have come out of the MIT Media Lab, and we're going to see two of them. And I'd like to bring up David Strand, who's the president of E14 Fund Management, who, hello David, please come on up, who helps companies emerge from the MIT Media Lab into the marketplace. And he's going to introduce two really interesting startups. Thank you, David.
Thank you. Okay, so so I am Dave Strand. I am a key person, I suppose, in the E14 fund, which has been set up 2 years ago in order to help people make a transition from their academic life in the Media Lab into the commercial world. So far, we've sponsored about 15 startups, and two of them are here today to give you an introduction to the technology that they've developed. The first is Leo Benani, who has an enterprise software system for visualizing supply chains that is very beneficial to his customers. And I'll let Leo explain his company and his product.
Thanks, Dave. Okay. It's fun to give a talk at 5:45 p.m. How's everyone doing? Yeah. Woo! Okay, I think I have 4 minutes, so I'm going to plow through this. I hope you all know your supply chain management 101. Like the back of your hand. Crazy demo at the Media Lab. It was my PhD, was a website that consumers were supposed to use to find out where products come from and presumably make conscientious purchasing decisions based on things like ethical sourcing. Problem was at the Media Lab, so we have a lot of corporate sponsors, and I demoed my technology, which was this mapping. This is actually a demo, so I'll click on something so you can see that it's live. There we go. And companies came to me and they said, "This is great. Can you show me what my supply chain looks like?" It turns out most companies can't draw a map of what they do in terms of where they buy stuff and where they sell stuff. The way that purchasing works is very, very siloed. Luckily, we were at the Media Lab, so we had this idealistic project. We ended up with a very practical project, which is basically an enterprise software that companies can use to see everyone they do business with, from the raw materials suppliers to the retail customers at the end of the line. Why would they want to do that? Usually you don't want to know your supply chain because it can only cause problems. Well, quickly, after Fukushima, actually we founded a month after the tsunami hit Japan. Apparently the whole auto industry realized they had been doing business with Japan and they didn't realize it for about 3 weeks after the tsunami destroyed one of their key suppliers. So we started taking data from companies like P&G and Mars Chocolate and IKEA and uploading it to this visualization dashboard so they could see at a glance exactly who they do business with, exactly what all of these dots on the map have to do. Are they distribution centers? Are they suppliers? The way it works is through a social network. They invite their suppliers, they ask them questions about their business continuity plans, and they ask them who they do business with. So they can see in a kind of a friend of a friend LinkedIn model everyone they do business with upstream and down, and this means thousands to tens of thousands of companies in the end of the day. And what do they do with that? Well, they just make beautiful presentations and reports to start with, things like where's our inventory and how much money is that worth to us? What is the value at risk of every single dot and every single line in my supply chain? So this is the kind of stuff that used to take weeks to do, and now it just takes a click of a button. But it gets better. Now the companies have all this data. They want to know where are the risks. Risks like climate change affecting cocoa growing, or risks like disastrous flooding affecting fuel supplies in New York City, another one of our clients. Things like this, so hurricane landfalls, statistically, where do they happen? And if you can correlate where your biggest value at risk is with where your biggest natural disaster risks are, then you know who to go after and make sure you have more inventory from. And then finally, real-time data. Once this data is in the cloud, instead of being in closed enterprise servers, once it's connected and being updated in real time and operationalized, then you can take real-time news and you can get notified. And so even if you have 500,000 suppliers, anytime one of them is affected by anything, if a distribution center is threatened by a wildfire, you'll get the SMS, you'll get the email, and you'll be the first to call and make sure you have all the inventory that your competitors are scrambling for. That's all great, but everything I showed you here was from a fake consumer goods supply chain with about 1/10 as many nodes as our customers actually have. This is more like what a real supply chain looks like. I think the screen is going to blink out at some point. When you have that, which is what everyone does have in a manufacturing world, then this software becomes worth a lot of money. Thank you.
Thanks, Leo. The second demonstration that we're going to do today is from the Pixels IO team. This is a project that again started in the Media Lab from an academic demonstration. And now Grace Wu and Shimon Yakubich have developed this technology to the point where they're ready to move on to some really powerful applications. Grace, Shimon.
I'm gonna have one.
Okay, so let's say we're at a great conference and I see a really great slide that I think might be useful. I might wanna do something like share it. So what am I gonna do? I'll take a picture, maybe put it on social media. So I'll take a picture and put it on Twitter. But there's a problem. Shimon, can you actually tell where the laptops on this map come from?
Well, frankly, Grace, not really. I mean, I can tell it's a map, but I can't pick out any of the details.
Okay, is there anything that we can do about it?
Well, I have an idea. You know, I could put a link to the slide in the slide itself, and I'll do it just like so. Here you go, here's a QR code.
Okay, seems pretty useful, but it's too small. I can't scan it from afar.
How about I make it bigger for you? How about now?
Ah, okay, yeah, but it's still sort of big. It's kind of like blended in, can't seem to get it.
How about now?
Okay, I got it. But it takes up a lot of space, and given the amount of time that the designer put into creating these slides, maybe we could do something better, like put in a video response code.
All right, I'll just try that. Here you go.
Okay, what do I do?
Well, you just do the same thing as before. Take your phone, point it at the screen to scan it.
Okay, I think I got it. So video response codes are designed to do the same thing that QR codes do, carry information and transfer it to between devices. But unlike the QR code, it's not obtrusive and it doesn't take up as much space. So now that I've gotten the data from the screen to the camera, can we queue up the mobile phones? What I might want to do is be able to transfer it from device to device. So I might have shared it with my boss, but back at the office, maybe my boss wants to share it with his boss.
Right, so now all I have to do is launch the same app, point it on Grace's phone, and there you go. I got a copy of the same slide.
Okay, so on a device like this, where the screen is relatively small and screen real estate is even more precious, we might want to do something like a video response code as opposed to something like a QR code. All right, back to the slides. So essentially, video response codes allow us to explain how, over the past year, we've basically improved video response codes to do better. So Shimon's gonna explain how to do that without slides.
No, sure, we have some slides for that. So when Grace started working on video response codes at the MIT Media Lab, her Newsflash demo worked with one type of a smartphone and one type of display. In particular, it required a dedicated space in which the code was embedded. Here, basically, there is a solid white frame around the image. And since then, we were able to get rid of that requirement, and now we embed the information in just the picture, just the image itself. Right. So, more importantly, the way that VR codes work, they flicker two colors so quickly that your eyes can't perceive it. And so initially, they only work on 120 hertz displays, such as 3D televisions or high-end gaming monitors. And I'm proud to say that this year, with the help of an NSF grant, we were able to get rid of that requirement as well and extend this technology to 60 hertz displays, bringing it to virtually all the displays around you.
So this is really exciting because it opens up a whole new world of possibilities. I might be able to watch a YouTube video and scan a specific frame off of the YouTube video, or see something in a public display and take the coupon from the screen right to my phone, or just be watching television and buy something right off the screen in real time. Essentially, we can create any call to action, Twitter, Facebook, on nearly any sort of device using this technology. Thank you.
Thanks.